Hello from FS Derek, and welcome back to my sort of series of flights in the Carenado B200 King Air, the payware plane. We're flying in X-plane at the moment, rather than sort of try and give you sort of a superficial view of lots and lots of different planes. I've chosen to sort of just fly this one and perhaps do it a little bit more in depth, just to show you how much you can get out of a plane, which is, you know, pretty... It's modelled in depth. I wouldn't exactly say it was modelled in the most depth I've ever seen of a plane, but it's certainly modelled in depth, and people have spent a lot of hours putting in programming in features and failure systems and things into this plane, which probably 99% of the pilots who sort of try it and fly it will never see. So we'll see how many more of those we can investigate. The last plane I had unfortunately ended up in the channel, so we've had a word. The Lloyd syndicate were pretty forgiving and paid out, because it was you know, it was obviously a genuine accident. Static elements and window reflections are all to do with the looking in the window and sort of seeing yourself staring back. You can probably just see that some sort of echo of the dashboard there. Obviously it's much better at night. During the day it doesn't really matter too much, and you remember it's a sort of a feature, a bug of this plane, that you can either have rain or window reflections, but you can't have both. So well, let's load the real world weather. So there's weather, grab real weather from the net, download right now. Don't know what download right now or read right now is. I suppose read right now might be, can't seem to zoom in or out. Let's try something else and regenerate the weather. Right, now let's grab the real world weather. It's got some sort of 1 hour timer on it, so anyway, we'll go with this weather, you know. Oh, it's raining. There go the window reflections. Okay, well, look, not to worry. Where am I? Where in the world am I? You probably won't recognise this. I'm in Rekjavik, in Iceland. Now, why am I in Iceland? The answer is, after we sort of had that heavy landing, I've flown the new plane around a bit. Now, normally, you could have come with me, but what I've done is I've upgraded my monitors. So I've got two 2K monitors, not the 1920, the ones that are 3840 by 2048, I think. And they're great. I mean, really, you know, when you're flying, flight simulating, you want lots of detail, and all these instruments and everything are in massive detail. On a big monitor in 3980 by 2048, you can get some fantastic detail. But the trouble is, I record everything with an Ava Media graphics card, which is good, because it encodes everything in H.264 in real time. So I don't have to, technically I don't have to render everything. In practice I do, because I put titles on and stuff like that, and end up having to re-render everything. But for the last few flights I've had fantastic graphics, but not been able to record anything, because the maximum resolution that the Ava Media card can record is 1920 by 1080. Excuse me. And so it's taken me a while to work out what I need to do about that, and the answer is to carry on using the big monitors, but to reduce the resolution. So I'm actually looking at it now in 1920 by 1080. on a 3840 by 2160 monitor. Now, you don't need to know all that, but I need to buy a larger resolution graphics card. But having said that, I only upload to YouTube in 1920 by 1080 anyway. So, all you need to know is I'm sacrificing some resolution to still produce these cards. Now, I flew into let's just get started. What I need to do is shut the passenger door. Now, everybody's aboard, and there we are. So we'll just go outside, do a quick walk around. With a walk around, what you tend to do is what you're doing now with a walk around. What are you doing? Well, what you're doing is you're just checking everything from the outside, and you're looking for nuts missing, bits fallen off, you know, burst tires and things like that, or anything really that looks cracks in anything, rust. Anything looks a bit out odd. Is the plane sitting down more heavily on one wing than the other? Might indicate that the suspension strut or the fuel's imbalanced or anything. So let's just zoom in a bit. Now, obviously, we won't see anything here, but the first thing you do is you climb in, you turn the battery on, and you drop the flaps. So let's just show that's one stage flaps, that's two stage flaps. And you can see the old flapometer here. There we are. So the flaps are down. And let's get rid of this. And then the other thing which you do certainly on a single is that you put the anti-icing on the pitot heat tubes. And the pitot heat tubes are two like metal tubes that stick forwards, and they measure the dynamic air pressure, which is the air pressure that's pressing into the pitot, the pitot tubes. Then that gets fed through to the airspeed indicator. So as you ascend, the air gets less dense, and so what happens is you've got two air sensors. You've got one that's pushing, one that's pointing forwards, so it's measuring the air coming towards you, and then you've got another one in the side of the plane, which is just passively measuring the air pressure without any element of forward motion. And the plane subtracts one from the other to tell you how fast you're going forward, and that's how you get your speed. So, and the pitot tubes are the ones that measure the dynamic pressure, not the static pressure. And they can ice up very easily, so what we need to do is check that the heaters are working on them. So if we jump back outside with a walk around, technically what you do is you start on the pilot side. So in other words, in this case, this is not where you would get on a plane, but on a smaller plane, you would climb onto the plane on the pilot side. And so what you do is then, so you're looking at, you're walking around, so you'd look at, depending whether you want to include the left wing first of all or just do it last. But you can run your fingers along the tips of the propellers, make sure that there's no dinks or nicks. Have a look inside the air intakes, just in case there's a bird nesting in there or something. With a plane like this, I'd expect it to be hangered or have some sort of covers over the engines. So after you've taken the covers off, you really wouldn't be too worried. But perhaps, you know, have a look. And certainly, you know, you need to have a close look as well. Get right down there, get underneath, put your head up the old suspension and just check that there's nothing living in there, big or small, because, you know, you could have a bird nesting in there. Or if you've got a little tube, then you might have like a wasp or something. Some sort of wood boring wasp could be living in there and just bunging it up. So as you go round, obviously you're looking at the state of the outside of the windscreen. Is it, you know, is it clean or is it dirty? You can't get out in the midair to clean your windscreen. Certainly the nose strut you look at very closely, because it takes a tremendous amount of weight. If you think about it, it's got a tremendous amount of weight on it, especially if you're in the habit of landing a little bit on the three wheels rather than just on the undercarriage first and then letting the nose wheel down afterwards. In the engines and things like that, certainly on a single, you've got to do things like drain the fuel, because overnight you can get condensation, especially if the tank's not particularly full. If it's half full, then the half that's empty will have air in it, and as it cools down overnight, then the water will condense out, and water and fuel don't mix. and the water goes to the bottom, and so and because the fuel is drained out of the bottom, because that's the it's gravity fed for the most part, even though it may be pump assisted, it's certainly, you know, it's fed out of the a pipe, comes out of the bottom of the tank, then what you can find is that you'll get to a point where you're just engines running on water. So what you do is you have a little cup that and a special valve that you push the cup up, and it just drains some hopefully some fuel off, and you have a look and just check that that is fuel and not water. If it's fuel and water, then you can see, because it settles out and the water settles out on the bottom, the fuel settles out on the top, and that has to be done every day, and the reason is that it can condense every night. So here we've got two engines to look at. The other thing which you can do, if we jump back inside again, is just put the, let me see if I can remember which one is the dial, so that's two. So what you can do, you put the recognition lights on, and put the, not the strobe necessarily, but the navigation lights on, and then let's just jump outside again. Which is shift four, and then there we are. So what we're looking at really is the lights now. So and then so you can, now you can see we've got a green light on the right and a red light on the left, and we use the conventions, port for left and starboard for right. So green, and that's very useful. If you see a green light on the left and a red light on the right, then you know that the plane's coming towards you. So let's carry on, and again we're looking at the undercarriage, the tyres, you know, fine. This is why we put the flaps down, because we want to see the full extent of the flaps and not all hidden away. Then we're looking at things like these wires, are there as many wires as there should be? And looking at the hinges on the vertical stabilizer, just check that they're all looking okay, and the horizontal stabilizer. And then, if I'm not mistaken, I think that's probably the static port there. Don't know if we can zoom in any more than this. I don't think we can. We can't go any closer. But that's the static port. So that's where you subtract the static port pressure from the dynamic pressure and to get the airspeed. So, and then I should imagine, you see, being the door being there, it would be logical to come out and then work your way around, wouldn't it, and then go back in the door. So I will assume that we've done this wing. So let's clamber back inside, and we'll put the flaps up, and we'll turn the pitot heat off. Now, how did we check the pitot heat? And the answer is, you do it with your hand. You just hold it, and it should literally feel warm. If it doesn't, then you need to worry. If and you have to do it quite quick, because it gets very hot. So you don't want to take 5 minutes to do it, only because you're going to be draining the battery, and secondly, you're going to burn yourself if you touch it a bit late. Okay, so all round checks are fine. Now, a quick weight and balance. What we're going to do, we're going to take seven people around the island, or, you know, just sort of over the island. So let's do a quick bit of weight and balance, weight and fuel. So we've got 2, 4, 6, 7 seats in the back and two pilots, so that's 9 people, and we're assuming that they are about £150 each, which is about £1,350, isn't it? So let's say £1,400, and we're not going to fill up with fuel. Really, we're going to be up for about 2 hours, so I'll put about 2 hours worth of fuel in it. Now, supposing you've got 3 hours worth of fuel in it and you only want to fly for 2 hours, well, that's fine, you know, unless you're over the weight, in which case that's not fine. And the answer to the question is that you cannot, or almost certainly can't, offload fuel. So you have to be sort of careful not to put it on. You have to be careful to put it on when you need it and not to put it on when you don't need it, because it's very difficult to offload. So, you know, if you're, let's say we land, and when we landed, as we did, we only had half an hour's worth of fuel left, and you only want to go up like for a couple of hours the next day, perhaps with a heavy load, then subtract what you've got from what you need, and then tell them to put in the balance. In this case, it's £1,145. So a maximum gross weight is 12.6 or 12 1,600 pounds, and we're 10,600. So we're 2,000 pounds under the maximum gross weight, and 1,000 pounds is roughly a ton. So we're 2 tons light, so we're fine. And most people, in fact, are thinner than my crew. The people I'm taking up, I've been quite generous. I think most people are about 75 kilos, about 150. 75 kilos? No, I suppose that would be about 150 pounds, wouldn't it? Yeah, probably a bit less than that, on average. Anyway, it varies. America is higher, Europe is less. So, press enter. We've got our fuel and payloads set up. So, I think we're pretty well ready to go now. So, let's go through the startup. We've got... So, we put the battery on. And what we'll do is we then put the beacon on to tell everyone that we are going to start the plane. So now what the beacon is, that thing that's flashing orange on the top there. You can just about see it there. Can you see it up the top there? And if you see a plane that's not quite like this with the beacon flashing, then sort of get out of the way, because it means something's about to start. Let's just turn the rest of the lights off. So we're starting number two engine first. So that's number two engine starter, and that's just winding up. And we'll put the fuel condition lever for number two into just above low idle, and we should see number two engine starting up. Good. And then we're looking here at all these instruments relate to number two engine, so we're just making sure that everything's fine. We're looking for everything to be in the green, so really we're looking for the prop RPM to be in the green. Internal turbine temperature, I think that is. We've got a master caution because it's saying we've got nothing's generating DC. This is the left and right DC generator warnings. And in fact, if you see when I put the number two generator on, you should see that go out. Let's just turn the starter off. There we are. And the battery charge. So we've got insufficient charge at the moment going into the battery. So we don't really want to turn the electrics on again at this stage. So let's do starter number one. I'm going to put the bleed air on, save problems later. And condition lever to low idle for number one. That's number one starting. Now I had a bit of a nightmare landing here because I took off early in the morning, about 4 or 5 o'clock, and it took me 2 hours to fly over here. And the guy who was supposed to meet me here was overslept and wasn't here to turn the lights on, so I had to land here in the dark. So I had to have two attempts. I had to go around and had to try and find it again in the dark, and then come in and land it literally with nothing to guide me other than the headlights on the plane. So that was an interesting landing. Let's turn the starter off and the generator on. Now we can turn the lights on, and we can turn all the lights on and just give the old windscreen a quick once over, a quick zhuzh, and we'll put the landing lights on, and we'll put the nav and the recognition lights on, and the strobe, and pop the old yoke back. So what are we checking? Well, let's check the fuel. I've redefined one on the numeric keypad to show me the fuel. So this is our 2 hours fuel, 450 pounds in each tank, so 900 pounds overall. And we have got to decide what sort of altitude we're going to fly at. So we're going to fly, I'm going to take it up to initially to 10,000 feet. So you can do that with the mouse wheel, or I think you can do it a bit quicker by sort of click and dragging up. So seeing as we're talking major increments, let's put it on 10,000. So going down, I'm pressing 3 to take me down, get the armrest out of the way. So we're going to go into a vertical climb, and we're going to want to climb at about 2000, which is our favourite climb, to keep the airspeed down to sort of 130 knots, and we'll fly on heading bug. So you notice I haven't engaged the autopilot at this point, so I'm not. So that's just set ready for me to press engage, and then it will automatically climb the heading bug. Now, what's the heading bug? Well, again, this is a bit of a workaround, but you have to. Let's put the thing here. What I want to do is I want to alter this heading bug, the purple things here, and to do that you have to left click and drag. And initially you want to line it up with the runway, don't you? So this runway seems to be about there. It doesn't have to be dead accurate, but basically when you take off from the runway, you'll want to carry on flying straight down the runway. So we're going to fly straight down the runway, and we're going to climb at 2,000 feet a minute till we reach 10,000 feet. Now the QNH is 29.66. You see we're at the moment, we're at let's just get that working. There we are. We're at minus 333, so it tells you that it's too low. And here we are, 2966, so we're pretty well at this airport is pretty well at sea level, isn't it? And I think the transition altitude in Iceland is 7,000 feet, so that's when we're going to go over to the standard international barometric pressure. But this 29.66 is the local pressure, it's not the actual airfield pressure. In fact, we can find out what the airfield pressure is by setting that to zero, but in fact, if it isn't 66, it must be 65 or something. So good, well, let's have one last check then. Everything is fine, we know everyone's sat down in the back and strapped in, everyone's nice and happy, we don't need flaps. So I think all in all I'm pretty happy to take off, so let's go. So I'm just going to take the handbrake off and hold it on the tow brakes, put the throttle forwards, just check that they're equalised in terms of power, that's about 1300, come off the tow brakes because we don't want to drag it all the way. Now watch the, if you can, watch the airdrops on the windscreen, because that's quite impressive. I'm just holding it with a bit of left rudder. It's over revving a bit, so I'm going to bring it back a bit. I'm a bit paranoid about failing these engines. It takes off like a homesick angel, as the saying goes. That's got it off the nose wheel. I'm just holding it on the main gear, and then you can hear the change in note there as we leave the ground. Up we go, positive rate of climb, gear up. And just to show it can be done, autopilot engaged. And you'll notice our climb now will stabilise to 2000 feet a minute, and when we're just flying it on the heading bug, and the airspeed is about 130. So we've still got the battery charging warning light on, which obviously is. Turn the markers off, because what we're doing is that's picked up the marker, the dot dar dot dar is the middle marker for the planes that are coming in the other way, not that they will be coming in the other way, because you only use a runway in one direction at a time, but that's an incoming marker for when the runway is in use the other way around. So good. So where are we going to go? Well, what we'll do, I'm going to try and turn right and see if we can't see some mountains. So let's head about 045. So I'm going to turn that round to 045. Iceland, I didn't see much of Iceland last night because, as I say, I came in the dark, and isn't that lovely? That scenery is really nice. I haven't really seen much of it. This is another feature of this plane. I just found out that you can put this down and slide this round just in case you've got the sun in your eyes, so that's quite a flash, isn't it? And then these lights, as you can turn them up or down depending on what you want, you know. That's one way of doing it. I think the knob is the other way of doing it. Or is it, that's it, yeah, that's the knob. There we go. Overhead floodlights. It's with during the day actually, it's 10 past 10 now, so it's, we're slowing down a bit. Now that's because we need to keep this about 1900, so we lose power as we climb. So I'm just going to readjust that to 1900, and also I'm going to drop the climb rate down to about 1500, because we don't need maximum rate of climb. We can satisfy with something less than the maximum and perhaps a slightly higher forward rate. So let's have a look at the map. Where would you fancy going? Let's pull back a bit. Let's look at the sectional map. That's the texture map. Let's just zoom in on the sectional map. Right, here we are. Here's some snow. The passengers only want to see a bit of snow, you know, maybe just taking them on a little jaunt. So you can see we've got a rose centered on the plane, and you can do that by clicking this thing here, show rose. You see that? And it puts a compass rose on the plane, and if you want to know get an approximate bearing to where you want to go, then that's pretty good. So we've got down here 360, which is the same as north or zero, 30, 60, 90. So we know we need to steer somewhere between 60 and 90. We know we need to steer closer to 60 than 90, so we'll say 70, shall we? So we're at 45. Takes a second just to get back, so let's get up here and let's change the heading bug to 70. 71 will do. But this sort of recreational flying, a degree or so, it's not going to make much difference. And have a look and see if we can see any snow. It's the middle of the summer, so we might not see any snow. As far as the engines go, 1900 I've decided is about all you want. You can push it to 2000. Once you push it over 2000, you're going to get engine failures, so why bother, you know. It flies pretty well at 1900 and something, and funnily enough, if we just zoom in, I can show you what I mean. So here, we're on about 1924, and that's fine. You can see it goes up to 22, but really, that's overstressing the engines. And here, the propeller RPM, you want that on about 19 in the cruise and the descent. We're only keeping it in first gear because we're climbing. As soon as we start to cruise, we're going to switch into a higher gear, which is equivalent to bringing the RPM back by coarsening the props so they take bigger bites of air. And the data sheet for this plane says 1900 in the cruise is all you need. Do you remember when we tried to take it back to 16 in it? We shut the engines down, didn't we? I'll do that again. So 19, and also 19 in the descent. With my old single, used to it's climbing at 1500, isn't it? Just press 3. Yeah, 1500 is what I want. Press 3 again and you get back to what you were looking at. In my old plane we used to find the prop on the descent, because it was freewheeling anyway, so here it said that for maximum versatility in terms of maneuverability, then 1900 on the descent is about what you want. So let's have a quick one. Now we're not climbing too high, so I'm not going over 15,000 feet, so I'm not really going to worry about pressurization. And what else do we want to look at? Not that. 5 here. So BIRK is Rekjavik, and not Keflavik, which is made a bit of a mistake yesterday, and was planning to land at Rekjavik and by mistake printed out the approach charts for Keflavik, was rather amazed because it seemed to have 8 runways. But of course, I was getting mixed up between the Reykjavik and the Keflavik ones. So I thought I had a real good choice of runways to land on, but in the end I remembered. What is this telling us? Well, this is where we're flying from. This is direct to, but basically this is where we're flying from. So the information is still accurate. We're just flying in the opposite direction. So it's 12.1 miles away. So these mean distance. This is desired track. And this is actual track. And this is the bearing. This is the estimated time en route. Most of you will know estimated time of arrival, ETA. But in a plane, really, you want to know more, actually, how long you're going to be in the air before you get there. So the actual time you arrive is pretty irrelevant, isn't it, if you think about it, unless you're the red arrows and you're doing some sort of display, in which case you have to be there to the second. Let me just go back and see what it's doing. So we've come up to 10,000 feet, and we want to see this start to settle down now. I don't think it is, isn't it? This is something I've not quite sussed out about the plane. You put 10,000 feet in here, you put it in a climb, and it climbs up to the altitude that you want, and it just carries straight on through. And I don't know why that is. It doesn't seems to be a little bit temperamental about what it decides to do there. Here we're down to 1,700 again, so let's put it up to 1,900 and something, because this is the altitude we're thinking of cruising at. You can see the airspeed starting to climb up here. 180, 190, 200 or something will be fine. We're heading 071 or something, and the wind is 16 knots. The wind is 2 knots, and it's coming from 016 or 16 degrees. So it's coming from the left here. You can see 016. One common mistake is to get confused about whether the wind direction is where it's blowing to or where it's blowing from. And it's where it's blowing from. So, which is a bit counterintuitive, isn't it? If you say, well, I'm hitting the wind is 180, you might think, well, it's going off to 180, but it's not. It's coming from 180. Always interested in where the wind's coming from. So if the wind is sort of coming from 90 degrees, then you'll want to land into the wind. So you'll want to use the easterly runway. So you'll want to land on runway 09, hypothetically. And that's what makes it so easy, because as soon as you know the wind, you know the runway, don't you? So if the wind is 330, you know you're on runway 33. Or if the wind is 240, you know you're going to be looking for a runway 24. So don't make things difficult for yourself. You know, just it's nice and easy. Now let's work this backwards. So we're at our cruising altitude. So I'm just getting a little bit of lag, I think, but it's more on the frame rate than it is on anything else. I'm just going to show you the propellers, because I'm going to press F3 to bring the props back, and you need to be looking at this prop dial here, and just gently bringing it back until we're on 1900 RPM. Then press forwards a bit. That's a little bit better. Good. So let's see what they can see in the back. Not much. Oh dear, look, they're going to be saying, "Look, you brought us up for a sightseeing tour, and what have we seen? Nothing." And they'd be right, wouldn't they? Let's have a quick look over here. Oh, dear. Oh, well. I'll have to have a look and see if there's a break in the clouds somewhere. I've switched seats. I used to sit on the right-hand side in the back, and then it was just Sod's Law, wasn't it? I just decided that everything exciting that was going on the left-hand side. So even now, the break in the clouds is on the left-hand side. I spent all my time looking out the left-hand window, and then eventually I decided to go and sit over there instead. So let's jump back up the front. There we are. Oh, there we are. They're going to see some snow-covered mountains, aren't they? I might come down a bit, but they're going to see something. Fantastic landscape, isn't it? You can see why people come here for the landscape. What a All volcanic, of course. Now, let's just finish off what I was saying about the GPS. So we've got distance, side track, bearing, estimated time on route, track, and ground speed. And the ground speed is 257 knots, although the indicated airspeed here is 220 knots. So why are we going faster over the ground than the plane is telling us that we're going through the air? And there's two reasons. One is that the as we climb up at 10,000 feet, there's no air resistance. So in fact, we are going faster than this would lead us to believe. 220 knots at 10,000 feet is equivalent to 260 knots over the ground. And the other thing, of course, is the air mass. We're flying in the air, and the air itself is moving over the ground. So supposing we were flying at 200 knots through the air, and the air was flying at 50 knots with us, then we'd be going 250 knots over the ground, because we have to add on the plane's forward speed plus the forward component of the airflow. It's never going to be directly behind us, so it'll have a sideways component and a forwards component, or a sideways component and a backwards component, possibly. So the forwards component of the air plus the speed through the air equals the speed over the ground. So that accounts for the discrepancy between the 240 and the 270. Now, you don't have to look for that 270 there, because you can see here we've got ground speed here, 269. So this is, I don't know why it's not exactly the same. It's probably, but it is pretty much the same, isn't it? So maybe it's getting its speed from a different source. But if you just want to look quickly and see what sort of ground speed you're getting, then you can see it here, 269 knots. Now, the desired track direct to Reykjavik is 267, and the reciprocal of that, if you subtract 180, is 87. And we're flying 73, so we are pretty well flying straight away. And what's the difference between the desired track and the bearing? Well, the bearing is the actual, if you were to draw it on a map, just draw a straight line on a map, then the line that you drew, if you measured the angle of that, would be 247. But to get there, we'd need to fly a track of 267. Is that right? Desired track. Yes. Or is that the heading? Oh, it's basically, any difference is because of the wind. So basically, to fly forwards, if the wind is blowing from the side, you have to fly slightly to the side. So there's an offset of some degrees, one way or the other. I'm not going to get into that. I know you think I can't talk about it because I don't know about it, but I do know about it. But it is very complicated. There's a thing called Cadbury's Dairy Milk Very Tasty, which stands for compass, deviation, magnetic, variation, true. And look it up. And that's because not only is the we've got bearings and tracks to worry about, we've also got variations because of magnetic deviations. So, in other words, magnetic North Pole is not the same as the true North Pole. So, let's not go into that at the moment. That's something for lesson 250, not lesson 5. So here we are, ladies and gentlemen. I give you the Icelandic ice pack. It's not, I don't think this is the largest mountain. In fact, I think there are larger mountains to the south. Well, I don't. Oh, can we see them? Let's just look hard. Yes, I think that's the main mountain in Iceland over there. But, anyway, let's see what the passengers are seeing. They're getting their money's worth, aren't they? Look, getting to see a bit of the interior of Iceland that they possibly haven't seen before. As soon as we get over the snow, I think what I'll do is I'll turn right and head down to the coast. Yeah, but it's not brilliant, is it? But it's okay. for sightseeing. So let's do a feeder check. This is a nice sort of pause in the lull in the proceedings. So fuel. I've set a view up for the fuel because we've got a bit of short on the fuel over from Scotland to Reykjavik last night, and I was got a bit worried, so I set a view up literally to look at the fuel and nothing else. But we're okay. We're 450 pounds in each tank, so 900 pounds. You can actually, the best thing to do it is just to calculate one tank and one engine. So how long would that last us? That's a good question, isn't it? 450 pounds. So let's go back and look at the dials. And the one we want is these dials here, the fuel flow indicator. And you can see it's very helpfully calibrated in pounds per hour times 100. So we're consuming at the moment just over 400 pounds per hour. So we've got about an hour's worth of flying left, haven't we? Which, and I'm sure we haven't been up for an hour, but we've got about an hour's left. And why is that? The answer is that you consume a lot of fuel climb in the climb. And because we're belting along, we're actually consuming quite a bit of fuel in the cruise. But as soon as we start the descent, we're going to consume practically no fuel. So what I might do is I'll just cut the talk back a bit, and we'll put it down to 350 pounds an hour. That way we'll have a nice hour, won't we? We'll still have 100 pounds to get home. So we've got another hour's worth of flying. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn south. Now, because I want to turn south now and work out where I want to go later, I'm literally just going to turn south. So I'm going to put the heading bug on 180. I'm being a bit careful because if you drag off the side of your monitor with this, then somehow the heading bug gets stuck to your mouse, so when you try and move it back, it goes all over the place. So, oops, I'm going to cut them back. Oh, I'm on the wrong side again. I don't believe it. Never mind. I'll have a look there later. So why turn first before you need to know where you're going? Well, the answer is that we know we're going south. Let's have a look at the local map and decide where south we might want to go. Here's us turning south. Here is, well, let's go the little big BIGH. It'll tell us what that's called. Gunnersholt. It's sky conditions 12,500 scattered, 14,500 scattered. Visibility more than 10 nautical miles. Winds light and variable, and the area QNH 1007, and we're 46 miles away, so that's far less than an hour. What about the here? That's Bicky. It's a tiny little airfield, isn't it? Probably too far. Let's go to Gunnersholt, big H, easy to remember. Big H. Let's just do a bit more tidying up because we really should have this on 1013, which is 29901. That way we're flying on flight levels. Whenever you've got this set in the altimeter, that's flight levels. Now we're in cloud and we're in Iceland, and the temperature outside is -6, so we've got to be thinking about icing, haven't we? So let's just jump down here and we'll put on the pitot and we'll put the propeller on auto icing, anti-ice, and we'll turn the landing lights off, which we should have done anyway. Do we want engine anti-ice on? I don't think so. We can arm the auto feathers anyway. That's about right. So, press F8 instead of 7. So now, can anyone see the problem here? We're heading straight into another Musgrave bank of clouds just after having decided to fly into a mountain. So, normally I wouldn't do this, but I'm an old bolt pilot, so I'm the only one alive. And it's only by sheer fluke I am alive. Let me turn the plane down a bit, because I might review that. Might be a little bit annoying. You know the plane's flying, don't you? You can don't need the hum in your head, do you, like me? So what did I say? We're going to Big H. So let's see if we can flight plan this. Let's push the cursor. Can we go left and put in a waypoint beforehand? No. So, just without moving the mouse, put that on there. Go to B. Slide the mouse over. One to the right. Slide it over to the left. Begin. Big H, gunner's halt. Enter. Accept that. So there we are. So we've put in Big H in front of Rekjavik, BIRK. And if we look at the track, we've got nothing on there, so it would be a bit daft to switch over to GPS navigation at this point, because there's no track, is there? So I think what we need to do is click the menu button and activate that leg, and now I'll get off the flight plan, and now we've got a leg there. Okay. Before we didn't have a leg to stand on, did we? So now what we can do is we can click that over to GPS, and if we click down to the autopilot, we can now put it on to nav. There we are. So we're altitude and nav, and go back, and it's made a right turn, which is encouraging, because it looks like we should be turning right, doesn't it? And it's straightening up in roughly in the direction of Big H. So I think we can say we are, the autopilot is taking us to Big H. And all things being equal, when we reach Big H, which is in 34 miles, we will then turn right 308 degrees to Rekjavik, and then we'll be home. So let's go back to nav and just have a quick look at the metrics again. So Big H is that we're about 7 minutes 40 seconds away from it. It's 33 miles away. We're doing 259 knots over the ground. The desired track is it's bearing 199. We want to fly 199, and we're actually flying, because there's very little wind, we're flying 201. So that's great. And that's only 2 degrees, but the plane's worked out that we need to fly to the right by 2 degrees. If the number's higher, it's to the right. So we were in the middle of a Frida check, weren't we? So now it'd be nice to do one before we land, wouldn't it? So what do we say? Fuel, yeah, is on sufficient. Fuel is on and fine. The radio, well, we're not really dealing with the radio at the moment. We could do if we go to special and toggle the nearby air traffic controllers. 135.95, and in fact, you can. If I bring up the controller and you look at the COM 1. I think you'll see if I click on that, it will set it. So that does save you a lot of time. So in practice, it would be much easier. It's a shame you can't click on these just to push them away. You have to click on the where it came from to put it away, which is a bit of a shame. Yeah, so we're tuned into the area controller just in case we need to file a flight plan. I might file a flight plan when we get to Big H and just let you know what the situation is with flight plans. Because you can file what they call a pop-up flight plan, which is basically one that's filed in flight. They don't like you doing that in real life, because first of all, it's complicated, and secondly, you know, it takes half an hour to, you know, you can't. If you file a flight plan, it's usually done by fax, believe it or not, from a fax machine in the cabin or the caravan or wherever you're taking off from, and you can't take off for half an hour, so you can't set an estimated time of departure before half an hour after the flight plan's submitted. And that gives them a chance to finish their cigarettes and drink their tea and sharpen their pencils and basically just get ready to look after you. Great respect to all the traffic controllers everywhere. Radio we've sorted out now. Engine, obviously engine is everything, isn't it? So everything, engine is everything. So are these all in the green? Do they all match each other? Yes. We might introduce some failures later on, but at the moment, you know, doing pretty well. And considering that the torque's only 1686, we're getting 210 knots through the air, 250 knots over the ground. So that's pretty damn fast, isn't it? That's pretty much the maximum speed under 10,000 you're allowed to do. So, and we're transponding okay, and we don't really need the ADF, and the weather's fine. You can click this, I think, to the right. Is it? No, to the left. There we are. Click it to the left just to reassure you that it's doing something, and it does display weather when there is weather to be displayed. So otherwise everything is fine, isn't it? And the direction indicator we've got between south and 21 here, and what we're comparing it to is this here, and you can see here we've got south and 21 here. Now, okay, pop quiz. This has got 21 south, so the 21's on the left and the south is on the right, and down here it's got south 21, so the 21's on the right and the south is on the left. Now, see if you can work out before we land why they're different. Why is one way round and why is the other way round? Okay, so that's the DI, and obviously AI is attitude indicator, which is, you know, we're flying. We think we're flying straight and level, and it's showing us straight and level, which is good, isn't it? And so AI and altimeter, which is basically set. So that's barometric pressure and 10,000 set, 10,000 flying, and pretty well stabilised at that. So you probably can't see this, but we're 17.3 miles away now from Big H, and we're going to be there in about 4 minutes. So there's the coast, and I'm sure they're all having fun back there, but I'll just show Willing. I'll put my head around the corner and say, how is everybody? Everybody happy? You've got lights over your head if you want to put lights on. Jolly good at night, and also nice to swivel around. Not a very nice effect. I'll just turn that off. Save electricity. There's one in the back as well. And there's also a red light. There's a torch which you can use if you ever get in the plane and it's dark. I won't shut that because see you have to. No, don't open the passenger door. That's a big mistake. Cockpit door. Don't open the passenger door in flight. Fortunately, it won't let you do it. That's good, isn't it? I'll show you something else that you can't do. Open the window. Let's just. Get rid of the controller here. You can open the windows on the ground, but if you try to open the window in the plane, it just, that's all it does. It just sort of opens very briefly and shuts again. And the reason for that is that at these sort of speeds, the airflow over this window is extremely high. And as air moves faster, the density of it decreases. So what's happening is this air is coming up the front. It's being deformed over the outside of the plane, so it's being stretched and speeded up, so as a result it drops in pressure. And so what happens when we try and open the window, the air pressure just literally sucks it shut again. So you can't, you might be able to in real life just about get that open and get it the other side of that catch there, which is probably about all you'd need just to get as much fresh air as you'd ever need in a lifetime. Which at 0 degrees is not much. Yeah, look. It's good, isn't it? That's when we fly somewhere sunny. So So that's the big, I don't know what they call it, mountain range, glacier, whatever. And we're coming up to the coast, so let's have a quick look and see what's what. Set course to 198. Well, okay, 198. We're flying on the GPS, so if we were flying, if we were using this to fly a course, then we would need to, but at the moment it's centred because we're on the GPS course. And it will be centred whatever we set it to, so that's really not that relevant at the moment. So let's pop this out again. So we're about 2.9 miles from Big H, and it's telling us in 7 seconds we're going to be turning right about 100 degrees, which is just more than a right angle, isn't it? Now, here we go. You see, as soon as I sit on the left-hand side of the plane, we make all our turns to the right. If you think about it, if you take off from Edinburgh, which is where we were, and fly to Iceland, you make all your turns to the left. So, there's no, we don't necessarily need to fly along at this sort of height anymore. So what I might do is, let's clear ourselves down to say 5,000. Just back on the mouse wheel, no clicking about. And then, so we've set 5,000 and we're gonna go into a descent. And we'll have a nice descent, say 800 feet a minute or something. And I'm gonna put in altitude select because I think that's what you have to do to get it to stop at the altitude you want it to that you've selected. I might be wrong. We don't know how to fly this, do we? We're only learning as we go along. So airspeed's climbing because we're descending at our 800 feet a minute. We should descend underneath it. Actually, we haven't descended a minute too soon, have we? Because we've flown straight into some clouds. So we go down to 5,000. We should be underneath it soon. We know it's not cirrus cloud because if it was, it would show up as green on the weather radar. So we're under 10,000 feet, so I'll put the landing lights on again. Let's put the yoke back. 10:36. You take people up to fly, they never give you any money, you know. Unless you've got a commercial pilot's license, which you might do if you're flying something like this, but if you're just like a recreational flyer and people, you know, you say to people, do you want to come up for a flight? You might be paying £200 an hour to fly them around, and you're forbidden from insisting that they pay. In other words, you can't charge them because you don't have a commercial pilot's license. So you have to rely on them volunteering to pay. And you wouldn't think that, I mean, you know, if you're flying a plane and it's costing you £200 an hour to fly, that's your decision, isn't it? If you've been invited along as a passenger, they seem to take the attitude that if there's four of them in the plane and you invite them all to pay £50 an hour each, which is what it's costing, they're outraged. So it's quite difficult to find anyone who wants to fly with you on an expense-sharing arrangement, because at the end of the day, they're all going where you want, aren't they? Very difficult to find anyone who wants to go in exactly the same plane at exactly the same time as you for exactly the same distance. And hello. Now it's been altogether a bit more laggy, and I don't know whether it's because I haven't fine-tuned it again. I'll have to get the frame rates up again and do a bit of tuning, because it's been altogether a bit too laggy for someone like me who's been flying since flight simulators came on 5.25-inch discs. This is. I'm very happy with this. But for those of you, sort of the younger generation, who spit your dummies out when you can't get 60 frames a second, then I do apologise. because we're certainly not getting 60 frames a second. I think we're probably getting somewhere between 15 and 30. But you know, flying a simulator, okay, you have to suspend your disbelief. Right, so we are going to so we're descending gently to 5,000. We don't have free to check. We have got, let's have a quick look at the timings. We're on the Big H to BIRK leg. It's 30 miles, with 30 miles to go. We're doing 255 knots. 60 miles an hour is a mile a minute, isn't it? 120 miles an hour is 2 miles a minute. 180 miles an hour is, or 180 nautical miles an hour is 3 nautical miles a minute. 240 nautical miles an hour is 4 nautical miles a minute. So we're going over 4 nautical miles a minute. So again, a bit of a mental arithmetic tells us that 7 minutes to do 28 nautical miles is about right, isn't it? So let's start doing a few more calculations. Ideally, when we get to the runway, we're going to need to be, we'd like to be around about 2,000 feet, wouldn't we? And we're at 7, so we need to lose 5,000 feet. And we've got 6 minutes to do it, say. So we need to lose 5,000 feet in 6 minutes. So we need to descend about 1,000 feet a minute, don't we? So what are we descending at? 800 feet a minute? 700 feet a minute? Let's just bump that up a bit. We don't want to go too mad. But let's just, you know, but this again, it's a nice calculation, isn't it? 6 minutes to go, 800 feet a minute, 6 eights are 48, so we're going to lose about 4,800 feet. So if you take 5 off of that, leaves us 2,500 feet. He's exactly right. Watto. Now, had a bing there, which has come from my mobile phone. So, I know weather front's coming quickly, but that one was altogether too fast, wasn't it? Anyway, we like a challenge. The local QNH is 29032, so I'm going to, now we're going through 7,000 feet, I'm going to transition down. So I'm going to dial 29032 in. It's important if it's lower that you put it in straight away, because as you can see, winding off millibars winds off altitude, so we are in fact lower than we think. So in fact descending is going to be absolutely no problem at all. Can you use a mobile phone in a plane? No. Yes. No. Legally, no. Practically, no. There's far too much cockpit noise. It's tempting. Supposing you were flying, and let's supposing your lovely spouse had dropped you off at the airfield, and was sitting in the cafeteria, looking at her second cup of coffee, thinking, I wonder when he's going to be back. It'd be very tempting, wouldn't it, to get the old mobile phone out and say, give her a ring and say, look, I'll be down on the ground in about 10 minutes, you know. But you can't really talk. Even assuming that you can make a contact with a mobile phone mast. And you know how hard it is to make contact with a mobile phone mast at 70 miles an hour on motorway. You know how hard it is to make contact with a mobile phone mast at 140 kilometres an hour on a high speed train. Well, think how hard it is to maintain contact with a mobile phone mast from effectively 5,000 feet, which is 3 miles away, going at 264 knots to, you know, I don't know, some ridiculous 210 miles an hour or something. It's, you know, if you get a signal, you're going to be very lucky, aren't you? If they can hear what you're saying, it's going to be a miracle. We're at 5,000 feet, so I'm pretty happy that we're not going to fly into anything nasty and pointy, so I'm going to put us down to 3000, so back to the autopilot, back in a descent. You can actually increase the descent, I found, by clicking on that and then altitude select again and back. So we're going, we're cleared on down to 3000 now. We're steaming in at a rate of knots, aren't we? So we're three minutes away, and you know what, we don't need to come in at this sort of speed, so let's just wind our necks in a bit. As we throttle back, you'll see on the annunciator down here, you see it says right ignition on, left ignition on, or throttle forward again. So it goes off and you throttle back and it comes on, and that's because at low engine speeds it doesn't want to, it wants to keep the engines going, so it's for every time the propeller spins round, it's sparking, just to on the off chance that you're trying to reignite a duff engine. It's a safety measure, not necessary for the low speed of the engines, but just gives you a bit more confidence that when you push the old throttle forward, they're going to start up again. Now let's have a quick look at what passes for a map on here and zoom in, and I am going to go north. I'm going to go north and come round and land on 13. Is that a sensible runway to land on? The wind's from 111, so 13 would be pretty sensible, wouldn't it? So now we're going to start flying it on the bug, and if we're going to do the reciprocal of runway 13, it's going to be runway 310. So let's put that down to 300. I know where that beeping is now, I'm not going to panic. And I'm going to press heading, and it's going to turn to 310. And I'm going to open the throttle a bit, because it's telling me I'm flying slowly without the gear down. So, and anything below about 550 on the torque looks like it gets a beep. Now anything below 200, we can put flaps down. There are two zones for flaps. One is below 200, which where you can have one stage of flaps down, and the other one is the full flaps, and you must be below 160 to have full flaps on. And that, the answer is because you're going to rip the flaps off. They make a big fuss about full flaps. You can rip the flaps off on full flaps. First stage of flaps, they're only just sort of poking out a tiny bit. Let's there we are. So we're heading north now. Are we heading north? Let's have a look. That doesn't look very north to me. Does it look north to you? It doesn't look very north to you either, does it? Let's go back down here. Heading. Autopilot's engaged. And altitude. Heading bug is 311. Let's figure this out. We're not in any danger of crashing at the moment, so I'm just going to sit here and work this problem out. Okay. Yeah, if we're running... Yeah, okay, this is where I'm going wrong. One runway 13 is 130, so that's actually a southwesterly runway, southeasterly runway, so I need to be flying northwest. Yeah, so that's fine. So I am actually heading 310. That's fine. Panic over. So where were we? We did the sparking, didn't we? Yeah. So we've done that. Oh yeah, flaps. So put your fingers in your ears. Just going to go outside for a second. Up on the cursor. Now I'll put one load of flaps down. And you can see there that they're just poking out and down a bit, aren't they? So you'd have to be going pretty hard to rip those off. But when they come down, they represent a far greater surface area and much greater resistance. Get back inside where it's nice and quiet. You can see we've increased the drag, so I need to feed a bit more power in. And flying it with one stage of flaps down and a bit of in a decent bit of engine power is really what you want to be doing on the approach. 160 is an approach speed for a jet. 120 is a nice approach speed for this. So we've got the Q&H set 229.32. Yes. I'm not going to use any Nave's data fields on. Yeah, data fields on, that's good. This gives us a bit more information. Desired track is 303. Now, if we're going to be landing on runway 13, which is, we'll want to be flying 130, so the desired track will want to be 130, won't it? So that tells us that we're actually not, we're on the wrong side of the runway, literally. There is RW13. It's pretty difficult to get any sort of sensible information out of these 430s. I've got a feeling that the other King Air that comes as standard has got a 530 fitted, which is got a far greater far larger map display area, you know. So, BIRK, desired track 305. It's telling us that it's still in front of us and 2.3 nautical miles away. 2.4 nautical miles away. So we're flying away from it. I mean, that's a good thing to look at, the distance. If the distance is going up, you're flying away from anything. It doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter what you think. If the distance is going up, you're flying away from something. And the same if you're flying towards it, then distance will go down. So, I'm not going to spend too much time worrying about this because I'm pretty sure I know where we are. Let's just slow down a weeny bit, and in a minute what I'm going to do is turn around. Now this racetrack point here is the racetrack, is the holding point for the runway that I'm thinking of landing on. So what we could do, we could turn around now, but we would get into trouble because we'd be too close to the runway. We'd be at 3,000 feet, but we would probably be appallingly lined up on excuse me, and far too high. So I'm going to go out to perhaps, you know, until we get past Rec 2, which seems to be the exit point. And then, so the aim is then to turn left and then follow this track back. And we're on, there's a 10 nautical mile scale, which means that it's, I think it's 10 miles across, so it's 5 miles from the middle to the edge. So we're about 5 nautical miles away. If I was very short of fuel, I might be prepared to do a bit of a maniacal manoeuvring just to get in. I think we're probably about there. So now we're going to want to turn left onto the reciprocal. So let's just put this away for a second. Let's get this out. So we're going to go around we go, and I've left it just, can you see, I've left it just to the right of the center line there, because I don't want to go across the center line because it'll start to turn right and then it'll change its mind and start to turn left. So just keep it to the left, and then if you need to turn it exactly, then finish it. So it's a two-stage procedure. Okay. So again, you know, you should be able to declutter this, but at the moment this is the best we're going to get. And don't forget the turning circle is smaller the slower you're going. If I was going at 160, I would probably make a circle about that size. If I was, now I'm going at 120, I'm making a much smaller circle. And we've actually timed that pretty well, haven't we? That was a complete fluke. We've timed that pretty well. I am just going to zoom in a bit. And you can see, you probably can't see, but we're just slightly right at the centre line. So I'll probably want to go left a bit. So, seeing as we're steering it on the heading bug, let's put the heading bug left a bit. Now at this point, you are really craning to look for the runway. And funnily enough, looking for runways is something you get much better at when you're a new pilot. You could be, that runway could be in front of you like that, and you could be a new pilot, and I could be saying to you, where's the runway? And you could be saying, I haven't got a clue. And I'd be like, duh, it's there. It's all right, I know here, we can zoom in. What I'm going to do is I'm going to disengage the autopilot. So I've got it set up for Z. But we can just disengage it by doing that on this occasion. And of course we get a warning. Now, you can see the, I think they're called PAPI lights, precision approach path indicators. And you can see here that we're slightly fast and we're slightly high, but we are fantastic on the center line, aren't we? And that's just telling us we've departed from our assigned altitude, but we're not really going to be worried about that anymore. Now we're on the final approach, so now would be a good time to put the gear down. So I'm just going to do that with the. There we go. Oh, let's just concentrate on this approach. I was just going to have a quick look and see what that said. Landing taxi light, fuel crossfeed, and reverse not ready. Let's just get my head straight here. At this stage you can, I wouldn't recommend you do this when you're 100 feet above the ground, but at this point you can actually do it because there's so much space up here. You can get away with quite a lot. Now we're in the second white arc, aren't we? So we can put the second stage flaps down. So I'm going to do that because we're still too high and we need all the drag we can get. If you're worried about these speeds, they are printed up here. Let me just stabilize them. They are printed up here, so you can see that the airspeeds are all there. And I'm going to do something which I did once with my flight instructor in the cockpit, which is basically just cut the throttle and point the nose down to the ground and rely on the massive, massive drag from all the flaps and the wings, the flaps and the gears to get us sorted out. Because we were far too high, weren't we? But you can see now that we're... That picture's looking a bit nicer, isn't it? As long as you remember to feed the throttle back in. Now we'll do a quick bomb fix check, so brakes are off. Undercarriage is down, we've got three greens. The props we need to find, because we didn't, so that gets rid of the no reverse available. We don't want to get caught out on the approach going too slow, so I'm going to feed in a healthy bunch of engine. And try not to hit that coming in. And fuel is fine. Flaps, hatches and harnesses, everybody's fine. And we just fly it onto the ground. Once you're pretty sure that you're going to be staying here, you can... There we are. It's on the nose wheel now. And then I always do immediately flaps up because I like to... make sure the plane knows we'll be staying, and we're not. No, I haven't used any brakes yet. I'll just use a little bit of brake because I'm going to vacate left here. I mean, and I know it's the capital of Iceland, Reykjavik, and everything, but they've done a nice job, and whoever's done this scenery has really cared enough to do this properly. And this is really nice. Nice control tower, nice hangars. Nice touch with all the other stuff. This line here, the broken line and the unbroken line, is the extent of the runway. So in fact, we have to get off there because until we've crossed that line, we are still technically on the runway and infringing the runway. And what I'm going to do, it's got a tendency to sort of stop. It doesn't roll at all. This plane's got. Very little inertia. I'm going to leave it here because in practice air traffic control would tell you where to park. So let's just say that they've told me to park here. So what we're going to do, we are going to reverse everything. We are going to turn off the strobe, the beacon, the recognition lights, the nav lights, the landing lights. We will turn off the electrics because we've got the flaps up, haven't we? We're going to idle. We're going to do the fuel cutoff on the engines. Oh, and we don't want to go forward, so we're going to put the parking brake on. Generators off, left and right. Battery off. That's the engines winding down. And lights off. I think that's everything. Good. Nice to land without crashing, isn't it? Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed the flight. Anyway, we've seen a bit of Iceland from the air, haven't we? We've got seven very happy passengers in the back. So, just to prove that the windows do open, there we are. We can open the window on the ground. So that's it for this flight. And then the reason why I came to Iceland, incidentally, was because I was toying with the idea of flying to America from the UK and seeing. And I'm sure this would, if it was stripped down and had no passengers and maximum fuel, could easily get to America via Iceland and possibly Greenland on the way. But what I might do is, you know, if you've got any suggestions as to where you'd like me to fly, let me know. Iceland's a bit out of the way. I can see myself flying back to the UK before I go anywhere. But then I'd like to go somewhere hot. So it would be nice to take it down to south of France, wouldn't it? Or Italy, you know? Spain? Gibraltar. Let's go to Gibraltar. That's a nice distance. And a nice destination. So, all right, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.